Hello, welcome back at Evolutionary Psychology. Glad you visit this channel. I hope you will enjoy this episode. If so, please help to spread the content of it. Thank you. Today, I'm going to talk about an as brilliant as important book by Jonathan Haidt and Greg Lukianoff, The Coddling of the American Mind, with the subtitle, How Good Intentions and Bad Ideas Are Setting Up a Generation for Failure. This provoking title and subtitle really triggered me, and its viewpoint helped me to connect some of the intellectual dots I myself was struggling with. So in this episode, I will try to tell you about the content of the book, mixed with my own views and ideas on this and related topics. I hope it will be as mind-boggling to you as it was to me. Haidt and Lukianoff are of course primarily debating the situation in the USA. People in Europe might think, hey, we don't have to deal with this kind of issues. America is a completely different country after all, isn't it? Well, yes and no. We don't encounter problems discussed here as severely as people in the USA do, but we know what is happening in America now is sometime happening here within a few years. They are the setting the trends for the better and for the worse. So we'll better be prepared. Signs of things to come are already visible right now. Haidt and Lukianoff pinpoint some very important and troubling trends. One of them is that we live in a culture of safetyism. Although there is less danger than ever before in history, our fear for it, whatever it may be, has grown to unprecedented proportions. Maybe because there is no dragon, the dragon in our heads keep growing and growing to an ever more apocalyptic size. In my video on optimism, I informed you about the psychological causes of pessimism. For example, the availability bias. We know so many examples of disasters, we also think they are really everywhere. The media bias, if it bleeds, it leads, and a lot of other psychological and systemic causes for this pandemic of negativity. While Hans Rosling has pointed out there is little objective reason for this state of mind. What has caused this mass hysteria, besides the one I discussed in the video on optimism? I think we can also point to the role we have politicians pushed into. What politician would win elections nowadays if we promised people blood, toil, tears and sweat? No one would. We don't want our leaders to have big, inspiring visions. We don't want to strive for grand, transcending stories that can lift us up, but at the same time demand sacrifices from us. Politicians have become managers, plumbers, hired to solve little daily problems, so we can continue our comfortable daily lives. Voters have become consumers, and politicians do best when they make no mistakes and above all operate as effective plumbers. Their focus is not on doing something good, but at preventing doing something wrong. They are more afraid of sins of commission than of sins of omission. And we have made them this way, enhancing the culture of safetyism. The result is a tsunami of legislation aimed at preventing even the most mundane causes of discomfort. Every little danger or inconvenience has to be tackled. In Holland, for example, vaccinations for COVID were postponed because the serum might have some minor side effect, for which the government could be held accountable. But the number of people dying because of the delay of the vaccinations and the damage of businesses and society as a whole caused by the lockdown, that was of less concern. And what's more, this fixation on safety has spilled over from physical safety to emotional safety. On the emotional level of this extreme need for safety, this has led to a growing number of people seeing themselves as victims. And since every victim needs an oppressor, this stirred a revival of the champion ideology of oppression, Marxism, which brings every issue back to a simplistic template of oppressor and oppressed. It was Kimberly Williams Crenshaw who was the most prominent promoter of the philosophy of intersectionalism. Depending on what and how many groups you belong to, you score points on the victim hierarchy. And of course, we should not be blind for real cases of racism, sexism or discrimination. But this ideology has really run out of control. It's doing to exactly the people it wants to protect more harm than good. Why? To understand this, we have to make a sidestep to some very interesting and most revealing animal research. Some years ago, psychologists conducted a very interesting experiment. Two rats, plus a control subject, were put in separate cages and attached to a device delivering painful shocks. They both received exactly the same amount of shocks, with the same intensity for exactly the same time. But one rat had a lever in his cage and he had learned to switch off the shocks by pressing it. And when he pressed it, it also stopped the shocks in the other rat. So the amount of pain for both rats was still exactly the same. But one was controlling his situation, the other was not. And that factor made a huge difference. When both rats were examined after some time, the no-control rat was in a far worse physical and mental shape than the other one, looking at stress hormone in the blood, alkaline in his stomach, resistance to disease, the power of his immune system, and the general condition of his body. So control, or the feeling of control, is of the utmost importance for our well-being, happiness, and effectiveness. And what has intersectionally thinking to do with this, right? It tells you you are a victim. It puts you in the no-control condition. You are not to blame for your problems. Someone else, or some abstract system, like white privilege or systemic racism, is. So you can do nothing. You have to wait until the system has changed, or comfort yourself by blaming alleged oppressors. It is putting people in the wrong cage of the Yoad control experiment. It fosters what psychologists call learned helplessness and an external locus of control. All conditions that don't help us very much. And furthermore, intersectional philosophy offers you an endless list to pick from. If you are not a victim of one reason, no problem, you can surely find another one. And if needed, more than one. In Holland, we see this trend in an explosion of children with one or the other psychiatric diagnosis, ADD, ADHD, dyslexia, autism, etc. Besides of the drugs we give them, of which we are unaware of the long-term consequences, we tell our youngsters they are helpless, victims, not able to change this fundamental condition they are stuck up with. Children make themselves helpless by telling themselves they cannot do certain things because of this diagnosis. I cannot read well because I have dyslexia. No use trying. I cannot make friends because people with autism cannot, etc. We have to realize what a horrible thing we are doing to our children. Then there is the culture of safe spaces. This is safety not in the physical or emotional domain, but in the realms of ideas, of the intellect, on how we think about the world. People talk about things we never heard of until a few years back. Cancel culture, trigger warnings, microaggressions, deplatforming, and of course the key word itself, safe spaces. It implies the idea people have the right not to be confronted with ideas they might find offensive or they disagree with. It's a very patronizing tactic of so-called intellectuals to protect people of minority groups. I just call it censorship. What you see here is the panel of the Golden Coach, the vehicle the Dutch king or queen is riding on certain special ceremonies in Holland. Of course, the picture is clearly racist. People from the colonies, probably slaves, kneeling for the Dutch Virgin, and a white man handing knowledge, a book, to a black kid. But does this have to be the reason to remove it, to censor it, because it might hurt people from the former colonies? I don't think so. It is part of our history. And it clearly shows the mistakes we have made in the past. So keep it this way and use it to educate our youth on what has happened in the past. The same goes for statues or names of streets and squares, named after famous men and women who were heroes for the Dutch people, but obviously had a dark side too. Be open about their virtues and vices. Do not censor it. That's the worst thing you can do. In episode 9 of this series, I discussed cancel culture and deplatforming at our universities and in Dutch media. I hope we have learned from the cases of Buikhuizen and Ramo Tarsing, and I hope we are not going to make the same mistakes again. Learning, developing yourself, by definition, is to endure pain, uncertainty, and discomfort. Every truly good discussion will hurt. Why? Your opinions are part of your identity. Having to change them because you realize they were wrong or insufficient can be painful, but it's the only way to grow and for our society to again approach truth one step further. The opposite, everyone allowing to have his own truth, like postmodernism is proclaiming, is not a healthy option. We have to keep talking, discussing and arguing. It's the only way forward, no matter how difficult it can be at times. Bestseller author Nassim Nicholas Taleb is talking about anti-fragility. Fragile things break when you burden them. Robust things do not. Anti-fragile things go even a step further. They go stronger when burdened and stressed. All living systems, plants, animals, people, are anti-fragile. Forests that suffer occasional small bushfires are better equipped to survive periods of extreme droughts and potential big bushfires than forests overprotected from bushfires. But also mimetic systems, like groups, concepts, theories, ideas, are anti-fragile. The essence of science is, according to Karl Popper, to try to prove ideas are wrong. If you succeed, they were. If you fail, then the theory has grown stronger, being able to resist stronger attempts of refutation. Some ideologues of safe spaces, let's call them the cobras, seem to reason the other way around. What doesn't kill you makes you weaker. Who's right in this debate? Haidt gives a vivid illustration that can provide an answer. Some preschools in America banned peanuts because of the peanut allergy of some tiny minority of the children. But what happened? Precisely because of this ban, the number of kids with allergies grew exponentially. In the exposed group, only 3% developed peanut allergy. In the protected group, this was 17%. And it's clear why. Our immune system is a prime example of an anti-fragile system. It only starts working when challenged. That's the whole idea behind vaccines. Post-traumatic growth is another example of this. It's not always wise to avoid the old causes of your trauma. Sometimes confronting yourself with what terrifies you most can start a process of positive growth and you becoming stronger. One of the best evidence-based forms of psychotherapy is precisely based on this idea, behavioral therapy. When you are afraid of something, don't avoid it, but expose yourself to it in little steps, with each step learning to master precisely of which you thought you couldn't master it. And on the other hand, the idea of becoming weaker by being challenged is in a way an example of a pathological self-fulfilling prophecy. If the kids where peanuts allergy were exposed all of a sudden with big amounts of peanuts, they of course will react heavily and become really sick, proving the initial conviction of the parents that their initial response to protect their kids was right in the first place. And as a consequence, they will enhance their strategy of overprotection. Self-fulfilling prophecies. You probably know these kind of quotes. Follow your inner voice. Your feelings are always right. Do as your heart tells you. Be true to yourself, etc. By the way, I doubt if Buddha ever really said such things. But anyway, Haidt and Lukianov point us at this modern pathology, the myth of always trusting your feelings. This idea is that emotions are more important than ratio. The rationality is something cold, oppressive, patriarchal, a relic from an old, colonial, sexist, racist way of Western thinking. It's putting Rousseau above Hobbes. When you study this idea, you realize it's just an extension of postmodern thinking, where everyone is allowed to have his own truth, and one idea is no better than any other idea, where the principles of rationality and the fruits of enlightenment are discarded. It makes possible claims are fundamentally opposed to science and facts, like the idea that male-female differences are non-existent or mere fictional products of social constructs. Facts are just optional in this kind of thinking. Something is true because I feel it is true. This ideology may make sound discussion based on fact and argument in fact quite impossible. I just feel it this way is enough to end the conversation. And the accusation of someone else hurting my feelings is enough to label the other as bad, aggressive or abusive. And of course, the more points you score on the intersectionality scale, the more you are right in the wisdom of your feelings. Not even intentions or factual effects of low-scoring individuals, like white, male, cisgender, heterosexual, educated, married, healthy, working, with moderate political views, affluent Western people, yes, I'm talking about myself, are what matters, but just the emotional impact the other experiences. That is what counts. I don't have to explain, I hope, what is wrong about this line of thinking. A concrete manifestation of the idea that emotions are all important is the concept of microaggressions. Of course, every sensible person will want to end racism. Debasing someone solely because of his race, gender, religion, or sexual orientation is never acceptable. Racist laws and practices should be erased as soon as possible. But according to the theory of microaggressions, there are more subtle ways of discrimination and exclusion. Things like saying, "You speak English really well," which could be interpreted as, "Everyone of your group speaks English in a childish way, you are the only exception." "I don't see color," which of course could be interpreted as, "Your background and what black people have suffered is not of any importance." "I've got black friends too," meaning, "I'm not a racist, so systemic racism is non-existent," etc. Why is this so problematic? What is wrong with the concept of microaggressions? The answer is given by a very successful line of psychotherapy called cognitive therapy, grounded by people like Albert Ellis. The idea is that it's not the external world that causes our mental troubles and suffering, but the way we think about them. And the way we think, we can to a large degree decide on by ourselves. Ellis made an elaborate system of productive and non-productive ways of reasoning. And therapy is centered around finding out how and what you think, deciding on the helpfulness or functionality of this mode of thinking, and when you discover your ways of thinking handicap you, trying to change them. Let's illustrate it with an example. Suppose you are very nervous when you have to make a speech before a big audience. What is causing this fear? Together with your counselor, you are going to find out, and maybe you discover you think people are laughing at you if your presentation is less than perfect. Maybe you think they will focus on your blushing face and the sweat on your forehead and armpits and despise you for that. These beliefs, true or not, will cause your stress. But Alice says you can change your way of thinking. More productive beliefs would be, "Hey, maybe my speech is not perfect, but they are primarily interested in what I have to tell them. And if I tell them well, they will be satisfied." Or, "Maybe I do sweat a little bit, but they will not see it, or certainly not blame me for it, because they know they would do the same if standing here." Surely this way of thinking will cause you less discomfort. So every external event provides you multiple ways of interpreting them and constructing beliefs about them. Cognitive therapy is helping you to get rid of the destructive and dysfunctional ones that make you suffer, stressed, victimized, and unhealthy. The ones that worsen relationship with yourself and with others, and replace them by more rational, realistic, and productive modes of reasoning. Beliefs that make you happy, relaxed, self-competent, and better your relationships with others and with yourself. Let's take a look at a concrete example having to do with microaggression. Suppose someone is saying to you, "Wow, your English or Dutch is really good." You can interpret this in two ways. The first one, the ways proponents of microaggression will encourage you to do, goes as follows. "He's downgrading me. He's in fact saying my level is still insufficient. He thinks all immigrants speak in a childish way, and he wants to compliment me for being the only exception. But he's insulting the people I feel connected with. He's treating me like a little kid. I'm not complimenting him for putting on his own coat, do I? So he must stop insulting me. He probably does so because he sees me as a person of less worth, because of my background." The second way of interpreting this remark, the way Alice would advise you to do, goes as follows. "Oh, nice guy, he's giving me a compliment. Okay, he does it in a bit of a clumsy way, not realizing his remark might be a bit offensive, but he means well, he just wants to say something nice. Maybe he feels a bit nervous in my presence. But at least that's a sign he doesn't feel superior to me. He's trying to break the ice. Maybe not that tactful, but hey, not everyone has superior social skills." Okay, which of the two is more healthy? Which gives you more self-esteem? Which one keeps your social contacts intact or even broaden them? Right, the second one will. So this is the healthy response. This is the way of interpreting science has proven is best for your mental health. So it's best for society as well. It's a bit shocking to discover a very popular line of thinking, the line of microaggressions, is promoting an unhealthy way of thinking. One which makes people more unhappy, worsens social relationship, increasing tensions between groups, and is overall more destructive than it is constructive. Note this, this is the second time we discover fancy ideologies, the ideas of the Cuddlers, go against insights from well-established school of therapy, as well as against proven schools of ancient wisdom. Because, as we will see in another episode in this series, this line of healthy thinking is supported by generations-old wisdom and most of the spiritual traditions from all over the world. By the way, Haidt has written an excellent book on this topic too, in which he demonstrates ideas of old schools of wisdom and modern insight from psychology and psychotherapy do overlap in a remarkable degree. I will dive deeper in this in another video. The last big conceptual mistake Haidt and Lukianov discuss is the black and white division between good and bad people. Some of the modern woke ideologies preach, if you're not for us, you're against us philosophy, uttering in slogans like silence is violence or silence is compliance. You are not allowed to doubt, to think over different positions, to express nuanced arguments, to say you do something good, but also be aware of negative aspects, in, for example, the BLM movement. The silence is compliance technique is a cunning trick to lure the many people in the middle ground into your camp. This strategy was used by many radical groups, on the left as well as on the right, and it's a way to discourage nuanced, fact-based and rational thinking. The core enemy of every fundamentalist ideology. Also, in popular books and movies, good and bad are always strictly separated from each other. The villain is only bad, the hero does only good things. And this is fundamentally wrong way to depict reality. Fact is, good and bad are never that neatly divided. The line of good and bad never runs between people, but always through the heart of every single individual human being. Stanley Milgram demonstrated this in a brilliant way in his obedience experiment. With some little manipulations and pressure, he seduced normal, law-abiding citizens into behavior we would only expect from a psychopath, an SS officer, or an ISIS terrorist. People that never hurt anyone before were pushed to a point where they gave electric shocks up to 450 volts to innocent subjects. Really shocking to see. Do realize, you could be an SS officer too. So please keep the nuance in loaded discussions on topics like racism and anti-racism. Yet another example of this all or nothing concept used by Cuddler ideologues is the pyramid of racism. At the bottom, simple statements ordinary people, not seen as racist, could make. It also contains positions validly should be opened for discussion, like the idea that disparities of certain groups can also be caused by the cultures of that group, a position I defended myself in the episodes on culture in this series. But according to the pyramid of racist idea, I'm not allowed to do this because I would pave the way for the horrors depicted at the top of the pyramid, namely lynching, joining the KKK and committing hate crimes. I see this as an attempt to silence any discussion before it really has started. And as our Western society is based on an open discussion of all ideas, this should, in my opinion, be an absolute no-go area. Freedom of speech, tightly connected to freedom of thinking, is one of the cornerstones of our society. But where did it all start? Where did this Cuddler culture come from? Haidt and Lukianov pinpoint a number of developments coming together at this moment in time in a perfect storm. First of all, it seems like iGen, Generation Internet, the digital natives, is objectively more burdened than previous generations were. There's a huge influx of students in top colleges and universities. Especially in America, this leads to fierce competition. Good grades are important, but also a broad range of other extracurricular activities are needed to get entrance. In Holland, we too experience a big growth in students visiting universities and universities of applied sciences. There's an inflation of degrees going on. Some decades ago, only a minority of youngsters visit university. Nowadays, many times more youngsters aspire a master's degree. Students are aiming for the highest, encouraged by this by their parents and peers. While it's obviously they lack the special skills and interest needed to become a good academic. It's a pity many people are looking down on good jobs like mechanic, engineer, farmer, construction worker, or doing decent blue-collar work in a factory. So fact is, kids experience more stressors than did generations back. Second, in the past, families consisted of 4 to sometimes 6 to 7 children. Today, most young couples aspire only 1 or 2 kids. On itself, this is fine, but the pressure on these privileged kids is many times higher than it used to be several decades ago. There's an enormous pressure to succeed, not to disappoint your parents. To complete their CVs, kids have to do well at school, but also excel in sports, music, volunteer jobs, international travel, and or work experience. You see, it is true, children have to deal with a lot more stressors than was the case in the past. In a way, they are victims, and this made them much more susceptible for ideologies telling them they are victims. Problem is, when entering this line of thinking, they are lured into the extreme versions of it, and then it becomes really destructive. Then there are the social media, the constant pressure of having a perfect life, seeing others doing better and not being able to catch up, the fear of missing out, hours of attention spent on digital devices. It sucks energy. Privacy has disappeared. Everything is visible. This feeds the dynamics of inclusion and exclusion by social media, which, as research shows, is especially most devastating for girls. 1 out of 7 female students report some kind of mental disorder. Parents react to this by giving children extra support and extra encouragement. More money than ever is spent for educational support outside of school, what we in Holland call shadow education. It has become big business, and parents are willing to pay. The style of parenting goes under various names, like helicopter parents, tiger mothers, curling parents, and paranoid parenting. Parents do everything for paving the way for their offspring. Jonathan Haidt, on the other hand, keeps stressing, don't prepare the road for the kid, but the kid for the road. Taking every problem away and at the same time putting huge demand on the kid can mentally be quite devastating. Children in Western societies enjoy less unsupervised playing time than ever before. Our villages and cities have less open spaces to play. Kids spend more time indoors, playing with computers and Nintendo. Safetyism plays a part in this too. A consequence is that kids don't learn to solve problems by themselves anymore. They can delegate this to adults, first to parents, then to kindergarten supervisors, teachers, and in the end, even to university professors or administrators. What are the consequences of this? I fear they can be vast. Let me explain. The basic nuclear family is in fact a kind of a communist entity. Children get what they need, not what they deserve in terms of their labor or economic contributions. This is of course quite self-evident, because little children cannot provide any of this. Later, in peer groups, however, they meet a more capitalistic kind of culture. Membership and playing together is based on reciprocity. If a child is only interested in his own needs and does not pay attention to the needs of others, he will not make himself popular and maybe even exiled from the group. Peer groups demand reciprocity. Okay, sometimes it goes your way, at other times you do things mainly to please someone else. There is trade. You give me something, and in return, I give you something back. It is essential for kids to experience these two radical different domains of life. And what will be the impact of the staggering decrease of unsupervised playtime is having on our children? I think they will not, or only much later in life, make in their mind and social orientation the transition from communism to capitalism. They are conditioned to others solving their problems, parents, teachers, university professors, etc. What will they do later in life, in case of problems? Will they automatically turn to authorities to solve them, or take actions by themselves? I fear the helicopter generations will be much more lean over to the first option, and look for solutions to others, to authorities and to government. What will be the impact of these trends on entrepreneurship, on expectations of government, of our political landscape, on the support for left-wing or right-wing policies? I can think you can answer the question yourself. Okay, folks, that was it for today. Thank you for your attention, and I hope you enjoyed this episode. If so, please like and subscribe, and leave your comments in the comment section. See you next time. Goodbye.